landscape. So I would now like to invite our second speaker for the day today. So our second speaker for the day is Mr. Rishi Diwan. So Mr. Rishi is a qualified business leader with experience in business strategy, product management, solution definition, business development, project execution. So a lot of wide variety of areas. He's an IIM graduate. He is currently working as a director and principal consultant at Off Grid Consultants. So before this, he was heading the EV charging infrastructure and energy storage business at CNS Electric, which has now been acquired by Siemens. He was leading the business vertical and he was looking after the end-to-end turnkey solutions for electrical infrastructure. His prior work experience involves working with companies like Panasonic, Corning, Dun & Bradstreet, amongst the others. So without taking much time, I would now like to invite Mr. Rishi Diwan to take over the session. Mr. Rishi, over to you.
Thank you, Dhruv. Thank you for the introduction. And I would also like to thank Mr. Pradeep for an insightful session before me. Taking the session forward from Mr. Pradeep, that where he mentioned that an electrical car would be at least 51% lower emissions than a normal conventional car. Taking the session from there, I would like to present the presentation for you.
Sure.
Yeah, can you see my screen?
Yes, it is visible.
Okay. For the EV market landscape, we have divided this session into four basic areas. First is the basic concepts of an electric vehicle. I'm sure many of our listeners today have already know about electric vehicles, but let's touch upon the basics of them. The battery storage technology, EV market landscape, and the key components of the EV value chain. The basic concepts. Let's get started with some very basic facts. So electric vehicles, as we all know, there are non-electric motors, which are driven by the EV battery, which is there. A typical comparison between an EV and a conventional vehicle would be a conventional vehicle has almost 2000 electromechanical parts as compared to an EV, which has like 20 components. Electric motors have single speed transmissions and they're efficient across a board of range RPMs, which essentially means that we do not technically require a gear system, but in some cases we can have a hybrid kind of systems also. Just an example, in the conventional vehicle for air conditioning, we use belts to the engine to rotate the compressor. In an EV, because the compressor itself is an electrical component, we can drive it directly through the battery. Going forward, what are the key components inside a battery-powered electric vehicle? This is just an overview. We can start with the traction battery pack, which becomes the heart of the system, which would replace your conventional fuel, a petrol or a diesel. Then we have the inverter. The inverter is required usually for conversion from DC to AC, from the battery power to the AC power for the motors. The motor may be the AC drive motor or a DC drive motor. That depends on the power converter and the technology which the OEM is using. We have a controller in between the motor and the battery pack to control how much current and voltage flows into the motor. It depends on the user inputs, what the user is driving the vehicle. We have the charger. We have an onboard charger and then there's an offboard charger also. We have the transmission of the vehicle, of course, and we have DC-DC converters, which would ensure the compatibility of various batteries and motors which are there on the spectrum of the battery discharging and the motor part. We have an auxiliary batteries also, which can store more regenerative currents or are used for auxiliary systems. Then we have a thermal cooling system that may be in the high-end vehicles, but on the low-end vehicles in India, we do not have thermal cooling systems. Yeah. So variants of an electric vehicle. We start with a hybrid, non-plug-in type of electric vehicle. Now, this kind of vehicle would have two drivetrains. One would be a conventional drivetrain, basically a gasoline-based drivetrain. So it will have an engine and it will have a petrol tank. Also, it would have an electric motor and also it would have a battery. So essentially, it has two drivetrains. That is why it would be a bit more expensive because of the two separate drivetrains. Then we come to the plug-in hybrids. So essentially, a difference between a hybrid and a plug-in hybrid would be that the battery can be externally charged also via an off-board charger. In a hybrid vehicle, the battery is charged only via the regenerative circuit while driving through the gasoline engine. Then comes pure play electric vehicles, which we call as the battery electric vehicles, which are based directly on the battery and the electric motor. It does not have a separate engine or a petrol tank. And it has an off-board charger and an on-board charger as well. This we just explained about the hybrid electric vehicles, which has two different drivetrains. It has a motor as well as it has an engine. It has a fuel tank as well as a battery station. And this is a plug-in hybrid vehicle. The difference between the hybrid and the plug-in hybrid again would be the plug-in hybrid would allow the battery to charge externally also as an option. The battery electric vehicles, they have a single drivetrain. They have a simple motor, a controller, a DC-DC converter, and a battery which is attached. And this is a zero emission vehicle. Okay, comparison for different EV variants. If you can see my screen, as you can see here, there's an internal combustion engine. This is a hybrid drive EV. There's an electric motor, there are power electronics, and there's a high voltage battery connected to it. So if the engine is driving on the gasoline engine here on the conventional part, and the regenerative circuit would again go and charge the batteries, and the batteries can take over optionally or in between, you know, both drivetrains can also be parallelly operated here. And in the plug-in hybrid, the differential would be only of the external battery charger. The rest of the things would be same. And the electric drivetrain, as you can see, there is no engine here. There is only a motor and a battery, which is there, a conversion circuit and a charger directly. Okay. The advantages of electric motors over internal combustion engines, I'm sure this has been a topic which has been discussed over and over again, but just to touch upon the major points would be the motor efficiency as compared to the diesel engines or petrol engines, an electric motor is much more efficient. A typical minimum efficiency would be around 70-75%. It goes up to a maximum of 90-95%. The dynamic performance, the vehicle acceleration, unlike the ICEs, the electric motor can deliver the maximum allowable torque at zero speeds. So technically, the torque is maximum even as the vehicle starts. In comparison to a conventional vehicle, which would slowly give up, the torque would go up as the speed goes up. The reliability. See, as the EVs has a fraction of the moving parts which are there, they are much more reliable. The breakdowns happen much more lesser. The regenerative braking is much better in an electric vehicles, and because the parts are too low and they're very less parts, moving components, the service cost of an electric vehicle is also minimal. The only thing which I can think on the top of my mind you would need is a braking oil change or a tire realignment and things like that. So there is no, because there is no engine, there is no engine oil, and there is no there are no oil filters. So none of those service costs actually ever occurred in an electric vehicle. Motor controllers. Motor controller is a device that improves the performance of an electric motor in a pre-arranged manner. Okay, the major components of a vehicle which we know is motor, power supply, controller, drivetrain, and a charger. So there can be an automatic motor controller or a manual motor controller, and it would also depend on the user inputs which we give. So a typical motor controller looks like what we are seeing in the image here. And it depends on the OEM which has provided the motor and the OEM of the vehicle as well. What functionality they are looking at it. It's a pure play power electronics device, which now we have a lot of suppliers here in India who are making this motor controller. So Indianization of motor controllers has already started in India in a big way, starting from the low-end two-wheeler motor controllers to the e-rickshaw motor controllers to the three-wheelers to the four-wheelers and then ultimately to the bus and the truck segment. The DC-DC converters, this is a very important component in the system, in the DC system, because it would match the power requirements and the power quality requirements from the battery to the motor. If your motor is a DC motor, it would really do the buck and boost. And usually it is bi-directional for regenerative braking also. So this becomes a very important component. Also, a lot of certification has to revolve around this because of, because this electronic component is placed inside the car. It goes through all the G-shocks which the vehicle goes through. But now we have very good, power electronics ecosystem in India. So this component is also indigenized now here in India. The onboard chargers. See, there are two types of offboard chargers and onboard chargers. The onboard charger typically would convert an AC to a DC. An offboard charger, what it would do is, if it's an AC supply equipment, if you are giving AC power from the grid and directly to the vehicle, it would convert the AC to the DC, AC to the DC on the onboard charger and then deliver to the battery pack charging. If we are giving DC charging, which is typically faster charging, we can give much more current and much more power directly to the vehicle, it bypasses the onboard charger and directly communicates with the battery. In that case, the functional of the onboard converter is for communication only, not for power delivery. Now we come to the battery storage part. Lithium ion batteries are the most common batteries which we use in the electrical car these days. They are reliable, they have high efficiency, they have high energy density, and they are much more stabler than other battery technologies in the EV space, not the stationary, but the moving parts. The lead acid batteries, they are high powered, but they are much more, much low energy dense as compared to a lithium ion battery. But they are safe and inexpensive, but they cannot really give you the kind of range which lithium ion battery would be able to give. Nickel metal hybrid batteries, they are very widely used in the hybrid electric vehicles. They have longer life cycles, but they have very high cost and very high self-discharge. So that might not be a perfect battery for a full play electric vehicle. But for hybrid vehicles, this is a good battery. Ultra capacitors are an upcoming technology, but they would be commercialized not in the time frame for at least from today, from 5 years to 10 years from today, at least. More about lithium ion batteries. These are different chemistries from lithium ion. So lithium is the, and the iron part, there might be a cobalt oxide. Then it is called an LCO cell, which is typically used for cell phones, laptops, and cameras. There are lithium manganese oxide, which is an LMO cell, which is used usually in the hand power tools. Also used in some polymer batteries in electric vehicles and medical components. The lithium ion phosphate battery is the most commonly used battery today in India in electric vehicles, primarily in the two-wheelers, e-rickshaws, and the three-wheelers batteries. The lithium manganese oxide, cobalt oxide battery, or NMC, which is typically called, is a very renowned battery used for four-wheelers also because of its high energy density. The nickel cobalt aluminium oxide is also a battery which is used by the likes of Teslas in the US. And the LTO battery is very stable at the higher temperatures, and usually it is used by applications such as electric buses. We have a typical example of a specific cell of a lithium ion battery where the specific energy might be 90 watt hours per kg. Energy density is pretty high in lithium ion batteries. The nominal cell voltage for an NMC primarily would be 3.7 volt. number of life cycles would depend on what kind of cell you are choosing and for what kind of application you are choosing. See, lithium ion cells would ultimately be put into a lithium ion pack. Now there is a combination of a series and parallel connections which we have to do to produce a specific voltage and current which is appropriate for an electric vehicle. So a typical battery pack manufacturer or an OEM of cells would, if you are a manufacturer of electric vehicles and if you are a user of electric vehicles, you give your specifications to them. They combine the cells in different series and parallel combinations and create a battery pack. Now, a vehicle might use one pack, like a two-wheeler would use one pack. A three-wheeler might use two packs. A bus might use 16 packs. So the packs can also be put in the series and parallel combinations. These are different configurations, how a battery pack and ultimately a battery, the entire battery of a vehicle is made. Battery management systems, battery management system is one of the most critical components in a vehicle. It actually is the brain of the battery that is being used. So it monitors the state of the battery, calculates various parameters, including the state of charge, which ultimately gives you the range of the vehicle. It manages the cell balancing systems between the battery system. And the most important function would be the protection. Lithium ion battery, because it is a very energy dense equipment, it requires protective circuits for over voltage, over current, under voltage, under current, over temperature, over pressure, etc. So the battery management system would cater to all these systems and more. So at least 18 to 19 parameters are at least there in any battery management system. Now we come to the EV market landscape. Electric vehicles stand out to be growing industry in the present century. This we all know. India is expected value of EV market in India is at least $2 billion by 2025. There are various schemes launched by India, which the last session, Mr. Pradeep also mentioned some of those schemes, including the FAME II. The global market is increasing. There were at least 10 million electric vehicles on the roads in the end of 2020, out of which 3 million were sold in 2020 itself. So you can see the kind of rate of increase in adoption that is happening now in electric vehicles globally also. So these are some of the countries that have made commitments to switch to clean mobility. Norway, Denmark, Scotland, Singapore, Israel, Britain. Even India has declared that we will have some percentage of clean mobility by 2030. China, Japan, Britain. China is the worldwide leader also in electric vehicles, but in percentage of vehicles that are there. Germany has declared that by 2050, all vehicles would be electric. Market opportunities in electric vehicles in India would be at least be a 206 billion opportunity by 2030. That is, I think we will bypass this number also at the rate which electric vehicles are being adopted in India. And the FAME II certifications which are happening there presently is phenomenal. I know personally at least 30-40 companies have got registered in the past year itself in the FAME II certifications. Okay. These are the sales figures for electric vehicles in India. This sources from the Society for Manufacture of Electric Vehicles. I think typically it does not include the vehicles which are non-registered, which are less than 25 kilometer per hour kind of vehicles. These are the market projections. As you can see, the CAGR for two-wheelers in the next 9 years is 46%. The CAGR for three-wheelers is at least 54%. If the first the penetration that is happening is in the electric two-wheelers and the buses. And now the electric three-wheelers penetration is also happening very fast. We all can see the tender from EESL that is for 1 lakh e-rickshaws that is out in the market right now. The key components of the EV value chain. The vehicle manufacturer that typically designs the battery, traction motor, power electronics and creates the vehicle sales. This is typically agnostic. Then the vehicle uses by the customer, and the aftermarket, the vehicle repair and the sale of EV components is there. So this is a typical value chain mapping of the EVs ecosystem in India. We would see more iterations to this space very soon as more and more players also enter into this space. Now, for the e-mobility ecosystem, the charging ecosystem, there are three main components. One is the operational control center, which is typically the software platform that manages the charging infrastructure. It is a multi-DSO, multi-service provider with a multi-energy vendor capable, usually. It has an app system, a cloud system, and it can get directly interfaced with any EV charging equipment, supply equipment, EVSC, which is called an EV charging station. So EV charging stations are typically four types. One is a residential charging station, which may or not require any connectivity. Then there are public charging stations, which are EC charging stations, which are typically slow. Then there are DC charging stations, as in the earlier slides, which we saw, where the current directly flows into the battery bypassing the onboard charging stations. Then there are battery swapping, where the battery is physically swapped at a swapping station. These are the charging stations. And beyond the charging stations, connectivity to the grid, we would require grid integration solutions. A typical grid integration solution is a compact substation, which has a MV switchgear, an LV board, and a transformer. So it directly connects either through the 33 kV grid or to the 11 kV grid and directly provides a 415 AC output, which goes into an AC or a DC charger, which ultimately provides the suitable current to charge and connectors with the communications stack to the electric vehicles. Depends on whether you are using a CCS vehicle, a CHAdeMO vehicle, or a GBPIT vehicle, or a Bharat DC-DC-001 vehicle. This is an illustrative view of what we just explained. If you can see on the left side, there is the grid, and then there is the compact substation. After that, the LV grid is there. We put up a EV charging station, and we can put up multiple EV charging stations together. And the control center, which is basically data on the ground, that would connect to different EV charging stations, and the users would have an app on their mobile phones, and they can access the control center through the app and directly book or block a charger, start charging, control what kind of charging they want, even pay online. So that those all kind of technologies are available today. OCPP is the standard platform on which communication happens between the EV charger and the control center, and on the mobile phones through the control center on 4G or 3G, we can directly communicate with this kind of app or control center. These are typical stakeholders in an EV charging ecosystem. Of course, the list is not exhaustive. We have just mentioned two or three companies in every area. A typical EV bus manufacturer, Tata Motors are there, BYD, Ashok Leyland, even Ather Energy is a two-wheeler manufacturer. Then there are fleet operators who are using this EV in the fleet functions. So there are state transport corporations who have either leased out buses or done an OPEX kind of arrangement under the FAME scheme. There are companies like Lithium Urban and Blue Smart who are running EV fleets. There's another company in Delhi, Tripoli. There are OEMs of EV charging supply equipment manufacturers, which are the EV chargers. There is the Exicom, Delta, Mastek, and a couple of other motors are also there. There are EV infra operators who use the EV chargers and put them on the ground and give EV chargers as a service to the end user. Typical examples are ChargePoint, Fortum, NTPC. They all are doing it. Then there are utilities who are setting up EV chargers on their own for the convenience of the public and ultimately electrifying the cities and making them ready infrastructure-wise for electric chargers. There are BESCOM, Tata Power, Adani Energy, all they are doing this. Then there are government agencies like EESL, CERC, BEE who are working on different programs for enabling the EV charging ecosystem in India. I would be happy to have any questions if there are any. That was all from my side. Thank you so much. My name is Rishi Divan. I am Director of Grid Consultants. We are into technology and energy consulting. Thank you. Over to you, Dhruv.
Thank you, Mr. Rishi, for the informative session. So we have received a couple of questions. And these are questions which are open so for all the speakers. So I will take up some of them for this session. For example, one question has been given to us is how much time does it take for charging a two-wheeler and a four-wheeler electric vehicle?
Okay. Should I take up this question?
Yes, please.
Okay. So a two-wheeler or a four-wheeler, how much time it would charge, it would take, how to charge it, it would also depend on the OEM specifications. Typically, a two-wheeler available today, if you charge it via a slow AC charger at home, it typically charges in somewhere around 6 to 7 hours at home. And if the OEM also allows the DC fast charging to happen, then it can happen anytime between 2 to 3 hours. But that would depend on the OEM and which scooter you have actually purchased. Similarly, for a four-wheeler electric vehicle, a typical time, it would depend on how big the battery size is. See, battery is like a bucket where we have to put in energy. So how big my bucket is, how big my battery size is, and what kind of rate I am actually using to charge the vehicle would typically depend. A typical slow charger for a today Indian available car from a Tata or an MG would take somewhere around 6 to 7 hours again on a AC charger, a level 2 charger that is 7 kilowatts. On the DC charging, if we do a fast DC charging, it can take up to an hour and a half to charge the four-wheeler electric vehicle again. I hope that answers your question.
Right, perfect. So that answers the question. So we have one more question. The participant asks, can we change fluid vehicle to an electric vehicle? So I'm assuming fluid here means a petrol or a diesel vehicle to an electric vehicle.
Yes, now there are some companies who are offering this service also. But there is an AIS standard they have to comply to where a conventional vehicle is converted into an electric vehicle, where the engine and the petrol things are removed and ultimately a battery pack and a motor is introduced. So this kind of retrofit projects are still under discussion and they are happening. They are also happening in the bus and truck sections and also in the three-wheeler segments also. So you have to go and find out that for what kind of vehicle you are looking for the retrofitting to happen and how much it will cost you. So this is an upcoming field in India, and ARAI has already introduced some kind of standards so that the quality of the vehicle is maintained when you retrofit it.
So is there some kind of price points that we have around these conversion technologies?
That would really depend what kind of vehicle you're using. So that is typically that depends on the service provider. So it is still we are in early days of these things. So there is no typical price point which I have right now.
All right. So we have received one more question. So it's a lengthy question. So the user asks, if we have a regeneration of negative energy, so essentially during braking or traveling down the hill, so we are able to regenerate during braking. So why there is no regenerative generation or charging during acceleration, the vehicle acceleration? So that is the question.
I'm not an expert in the mechanical areas. Maybe other of my colleagues can answer this, but to the best information which I have is you can do regenerative charging during acceleration also, but it would ultimately hamper the output of power that you are trying to give to your drivetrain immediately. If you are transferring some of that power against the acceleration, then your vehicle performance might go down a bit. But there are some companies who are actually doing in the high-end vehicles, they are doing regenerative charging during acceleration also. So yes, that is a complex thing, but that depends on the OEM who has designed the car.
Perfect. So in fact, I agree with you. So the energy that we generate in the vehicle, that is limited. So and if a part of that energy goes into regeneration, that of course implies that the amount of energy that we are left with for the vehicle to accelerate itself will go down. Yeah, so I completely agree with that thought. Is there any scope for setting up your own company, so a startup in retrofitting of vehicles from conventional fuel technologies to electric vehicles. How big is the market? Essentially, that is what I understand the question is.
If you can answer this question, that would be great.
Okay. So if I have to take that question, so I think the market is there, of course. But there are a few discussions that I have been a part of where it is not about the feasibility of the technology or the cost of technology, but the concerns have been raised more around the safety of the vehicle itself. Because when you convert an existing vehicle into a battery vehicle, and these vehicles are not designed keeping in mind that the batteries will eventually be fitted into these vehicles, so the chassis is designed in a different fashion. So there have been certain discussions around it where it has been felt that the safety of the vehicle which has been converted gets compromised a bit if it is converted into electrical compared to a vehicle which has been designed as an electric vehicle from the beginning, from the very start. So which is why there are certain, I would say, barriers on, you know, these kind of safety checks and approvals by the regulatory agencies in India. But of course, that's a market which is prevalent in the three-wheeler segment is what I've seen from my own personal experience. And of course, we will talk to other speakers as well as we go along the session. But I hope that answers the question to an extent. Right. So thank you, Mr. Rishi, and thank you for sharing your insights during the session today. It was wonderful to be hearing from you. And I hope that you will stay with us in this session as we go along and we listen to the other speakers for the day.
Thank you. Thank you,
Dhruv. Right. So moving on, let's quickly move on to our next session and our next speaker. So I would now like to invite our speaker for the next session, which is around certain numbers. Let's look at some economics. Let's look at how vehicle cost or operational cost or capital cost of an electric vehicle compares to a conventional fuel vehicle. Let's look at some of those numbers, some of those statistics. And to talk about those, we have Dr. Parveen Kumar with us. He is a senior manager at WRI, World Resource Institute, India, and he works under the Citizen Program team there. He is currently associated with the projects related to the EV ecosystem at WRI. Prior to this, he has worked at Indian